Bonnie Webster, Associate Provost for Academic Programs and Professor in the Department of Nursing and Allied Health at the University of the District of Columbia, and your host for Health Matters. Our purpose is to assist you in managing your health care by providing you balanced information and resources to help you make knowledgeable choices about your health. And I'm delighted to have as my guest on this edition of Health Matters, Dr. Maggie Covington. And our discussion will be about functional medicine approaches to the treatment of SIBO, or small intestinal bacteria overgrowth, and irritable bowel syndrome, or IBS. Dr. Covington's practice is Partners in Health, a multidisciplinary group of practitioners who provide services to children, adults, and families. Dr. Covington and her colleagues work in an integrated and interdisciplinary fashion to combine the best practices of traditional and integrative or functional medicine approaches. Dr. Covington is a family physician who practices functional medicine. She received her medical degree from Howard University College of Medicine and completed her training in family medicine at the University of Maryland Medical Center. Dr. Covington completed additional training in nutrition and functional medicine through the Institute of Functional Medicine and medical acupuncture through the Helms Medical Institute at UCLA. She has held academic faculty positions at Howard University College of Medicine, the University of Southern California School of Medicine, and the University of Maryland School of Medicine. Dr. Covington, yes. Welcome to Health Matters.
Thank you, Dr. Webster, for having me.
Oh, I'm so pleased that you could be here with us.
Thank you.
We're going to talk about a very timely and serious issue, but we're kind of coming at it from a different approach.
Exactly.
In as much as we're talking about functional medicine.
Exactly.
And so, for starters, just so that our viewers are on the same page as we are, let's talk a little bit about exactly what functional medicine is.
I'd be happy to. Well, functional medicine, I was obviously trained as a conventional practitioner. Mm-hmm. And after I finished my residency, I was exposed to sort of a different toolbox. And functional medicine is one of those. It really looks at the body as a whole. Mm-hmm. And the idea of organ systems being isolated, you know, that we have specialties like gastroenterology,
yes,
and neurology, and,
yeah, cardiology,
and cardiology. That the idea that we have to treat organ systems as separate entities is totally, I think, off the mark. And with functional medicine, we're looking at the interplay of all of the systems in the body, including the emotions, including how the environment, mm-hmm, how our genes interplay with the function of our organs. Mm-hmm. And so it really is a truly holistic approach
that
to
word, holistic
care.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And many times in medicine, as well as nursing, my field, we talk about a holistic approach, while at the same time, we're doing exactly what you said. Cardiologists, you know, the urologist,
exactly,
the whatever, and we're breaking it in. So what you're saying is that all of this in your practice is taken into consideration by one beautiful little lady like you, correct?
Exactly, exactly.
Oh, okay, so let me just ask for some other clarity. So we hear people talking about alternative medicine or naturalistic medicine approaches. Kind of bring this in and clarify, if you will, if we can say it, mm-hmm, this way, connecting the dots of how all this interplay, what is the difference, or if they are the same.
And that's a term that I use a lot when I talk to my patients, mm-hmm, that what we do and what we're setting out to do is to connect the dots between, mm-hmm, their symptoms. Mm-hmm. That they come in with perhaps a disparate, a lot of different symptoms, uh-huh, that don't seem to be related. Uh-huh. And when we're talking about functional medicine, alternative approaches to care, mm-hmm. we're looking at how can we make the connection between these symptoms? How can we get back to the original cause?
Right.
Not just treating the symptoms.
Right.
But what caused those? What were the triggers?
Triggers, yes.
And the antecedent, what came before.
Uh-huh.
And we go back as far as the womb.
Oh, wow.
You know, what happened during the time that you were in your mother's womb? Was she excessively stressed?
Right.
Was she a smoker? Was she abused? What was going on? Because that will impact the type of disorders that you develop as an adult.
Oh.
And so we're looking at the full spectrum, not just what's happening right now, mm-hmm. but what happened in your history. Mm-hmm. We take a very, very detailed history.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we talk about the difference between alternative, natural, functional medicine, it really all rolls into one.
Right. Functional, just the term, is so all-encompassing because it's not just one approach as Western medicine may look at it, or even for a holistic approach, one focusing on one particular area, one particular thing.
That's right.
But functional, it's everything.
How the body functions
in our
environment.
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Really cool. And as we start to go into our topic, our topic of small intestinal bowel, I really appreciated something that we shared and that you said, and that you said that you feel, and it is, I guess, sort of an underpinning of your practice, that the whole body has the propensity to heal itself and given those things. So when we start to talk about our gut,
that's really what we're
that's what we're talking about.
Exactly.
But when we're talking about the small intestinal and bacterial overgrowth,
yes.
Right away one might assume, and it is true, that there is a natural growth population of bacteria in the bowel, right? And so when we start to talk about overgrowth and the irritability that comes from that, help the viewers to understand exactly some of those environmental things, some mm-hmm. of those other mm-hmm. kinds of mm-hmm. realms in their life that might impact this.
Okay. Well, I think most people have heard about IBS, or Irritable Bowel Syndrome. And it's a very, very common occurrence, particularly in women. Mm-hmm. And it can be manifested as diarrhea or constipation or an alternation between the two, mm-hmm. cramping, discomfort, bloating. And for years, we really didn't know what the cause was mm-hmm. for this.
Mm-hmm.
And so all people told patients to do really was increase your fiber. Okay.
Or watch what you eat.
Watch what you eat, mm-hmm. increase your fiber. Wasn't a lot that we could do.
Mm-hmm.
Now we understand that the majority of cases are due either to a previous infection, like a gastroenteritis, mm-hmm. you know, where you get food poisoning.
Mm-hmm.
And 80% of the time it's due to this small intestinal bacterial overgrowth.
Uh-huh.
Or SIBO.
Mm-hmm.
And the small intestine really should be relatively sterile.
Right.
Interesting.
Right.
Once you get into the large intestine, that's where you get a lot of the bacteria,
yes.
and we
mm-hmm.
hear a lot about probiotics and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
But the small intestine should be sterile.
Okay.
What happens when certain things, like for instance somebody that has constipation, things slow down.
Right. Or stop.
Or stop. Completely.
Correct.
And so mm-hmm. those bacteria, that waste, doesn't have an opportunity to move through.
Through the system,
okay?
Mm-hmm.
And SIBO is something that most physicians aren't thinking about.
Right.
And if you don't think about it, you can't diagnose it mm-hmm. and treat it.
Mm-hmm.
So we ask the question, what are the major causes of the SIBO?
Okay.
Besides the original infection. Interestingly, low stomach acid is a very, very common cause because the stomach acid is supposed to kill off those bacteria before they get into the small intestine.
Right, right.
It's supposed to help us digest our food properly.
Mm-hmm.
And what's one of the major medications that we use in this country? They're the
mm-hmm.
acid blockers.
Acid blockers. Mm-hmm.
Your you know, Protonix, your Nexium, your Zantac, your things that you can buy over the counter. And not only do we take those for a few weeks, people stay on them for years, indefinitely. The side effect of that is low stomach acid, not adequate stomach acid. So that will set you up for this overgrowth of the bacteria, which will lead to bloating, to discomfort, to pain, to excess belching, excess gas.
So let me just ask one thing now. That there are some common questions when physicians are doing intake. And your bowel habits are one.
They should.
And what medications are you on would be another.
Very good question.
I'm saying, shouldn't these raise some red flags for physicians when one starts to look at that and associate that with the symptoms?
It should, you would think. You would think, but we don't often think about what are the long-term repercussions of medications. We're more focused in conventional medicine of treating the symptoms. You know, and patients want that, doctors want that. They don't have a lot of time to spend with patients. 15 minutes and you want, you know, a prescription and get out the door. So functional medicine spends time. I usually spend an hour and a half to 2 hours with a new patient.
Oh my goodness.
An hour with a follow-up patient visit. And so we have the time to listen. We have the time to figure out, oh, is this a side effect of the medication? What kinds of foods are you eating that may be triggering or exacerbating these symptoms? So it's an opportunity for the patient to talk, for us to listen, to really get a full history and figure out this puzzle, you know, the mystery.
And let's just say in terms of this whole process, once a patient gets in and you identify, you start to put all these puzzle pieces together, what would be an environmental question that might be associated with this?
That's a great question. So an environmental question might be, well, related to SIBO? Environment, one of the things that you would think about is diet. And I don't know, that's maybe not exactly environmental, but that's huge when it comes to SIBO. Because there are certain foods that will increase the production of certain gases by these bacteria. They're called foods that are high in, we call high FODMAP foods, but these are foods that will produce excess gases. So for instance, onions, garlic, things
cabbage.
That we use a lot of.
Love cabbage. The beans.
Potato, beans. They're foods that will increase the production of these gases. And so part of the therapy is to eat a prescribed diet that will lower the production of those gases. And so generally that consists of vegetables, you know, your animal protein. You're avoiding sugars. That's huge. And usually it's for a prescribed period of time. There are other therapies that we use, herbals, such as garlic, oregano, berberine, things that may be familiar, maybe not so familiar. And as well as certain antibiotics. So we do use conventional treatment as well as...
The function non-conventional treatment. I was thinking also as I was asking that question, and it may be one that our viewers were kind of headed toward in terms of organic versus inorganic foods because of the pesticides and some of the other things that might be included in growth. Has it been a part of your practice to find that, you know, if a consumer focuses more on, and it may not, organic versus non-organic, especially with vegetables, if we're going to ask them to eat more, that that might make a difference? And for people who are lactose intolerant, would that be a problem?
Well, that definitely is a problem, and the lactose, as well as the protein in dairy, mm-hmm. is a problem. The protein called casein,
yes.
is a problem for a lot of people, and they don't realize it.
Right.
So they're walking around bloated,
yes.
uncomfortable, and
yes.
they don't realize that certain foods, such as dairy,
yes.
the protein,
yes.
the sugar, lactose,
yeah.
are really causing a problem.
Mm-hmm.
As far as the environmental issues such as organic versus non-organic, that is important in the overall health of a person. Not particularly in healing the SIBO, but you know, we talk about toxicity overload,
mm-hmm.
and that's a big part of what we do, is helping people to detoxify these environmental issues.
Yes.
And if your body is overloaded with toxins, whether it's pesticides, chemicals,
preservatives,
yes. you know, cleaning
yes.
supplies, yes. makeup,
yes.
all of these things,
mm-hmm.
Our body has to detoxify those.
Yes.
And the more things that your body has to work to do, the less able it is to defend against
right.
bacteria, defend
right.
against infection.
Right.
So that's a huge part of what we look at with functional medicine, is how our body naturally is supposed to function.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We're naturally supposed to be able to detoxify.
Mm-hmm.
But when we overload it,
mm-hmm.
it's difficult.
Right.
Okay? And
right.
your risk for chronic disorders like autoimmune issues,
mm-hmm.
Fatigue,
right.
Depression,
right.
and anxiety goes up significantly if you have issues with detoxification.
So if I were thinking about always trying to be, to have good intestinal health.
Yes, yes.
And specifically being concerned about my food getting through the whole intestinal system.
Yes, yes.
Would I feel some specific group of symptoms that with my constipation, if it were small bowel versus the colon, the lower part of the bowel?
Well, with the small bowel, you're really going to have a lot more bloating
mm-hmm.
in the upper intestine, perhaps
mm-hmm.
belching
mm-hmm.
after your meals.
Right, right, right,
okay,
right, right.
Okay, you're not digesting your food. Most of your digestion and absorption of nutrients happens in the small intestine.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so you think about it, if you have a lot of bacteria
right.
growing there.
Correct.
They're competing for your nutrients.
Right.
You're not going to be able to digest your food
right.
as well as you should, because those bacteria are impeding that.
Right.
Process.
And they give off a little gases too.
They're eating your food.
Yes.
And they're giving off the gases
right.
and making you very uncomfortable.
And whereas if it were lower colon, you have, it's a different kind of pressure
and
feel like you want to go.
And you may not be able to go.
Can't go.
And I have patients say, well, no, I'm not constipated, but I go to the bathroom maybe twice a week.
Mm-hmm.
I say, that's constipated.
Yes.
Even if it's normal for you. And they'll say, I've been doing that since I've been a child.
But that's still.
You need to go every single
every day.
Every day. Every single day.
Absolutely.
That's part of a healthy detoxification and cleansing process.
So let's talk about this healthy part of it all.
Yeah.
What can I do to really ensure, well, that I'm doing the right thing to make sure that this food, this whole digestive process is correct and,
mm-hmm.
you know, that the food is not just sitting in my small. Are there particular, you mentioned some things that you prescribe.
Exactly.
Should I include them in my diet? And I know we're going to talk about drinking water and flushing and all that.
Mm-hmm.
But are there some things that I should include to get the best possible effect when I'm cooking or doing things like that?
Well, you want to include foods that are, for instance, whole foods, not just processed foods.
Yeah.
Whole foods are going to have a lot more fiber,
yeah.
first of all.
Yes.
They're going to have a lot more nutrients
mm-hmm.
in them that
mm-hmm.
we need to function properly. It's going to help things move through.
Mm-hmm.
And you want to do things that are going to help you digest that food. Mm-hmm. Simple things, like starting the day off with a glass of warm water with a half a lemon squeezed in
it. I've heard that before.
Okay? Uh-huh. What that does is to increase the acidity of your stomach, but it also alkalinizes. It produces an alkaline ash that alkalinizes the rest of the body.
Okay.
And we know that, generally speaking, we are a lot healthier mm-hmm. when our body is more on the alkaline side.
Uh-huh.
Okay? Cancer cells do not grow as easily mm-hmm. in an alkaline environment.
Mm-hmm.
And so starting your day off with either a glass of warm water and lemon juice or apple cider vinegar. That's another. A tablespoon of apple cider vinegar in warm water can help to kind of jumpstart the production of your own stomach acid.
Okay.
I also often use a supplement that can do that for people who really need a lot more help with mm-hmm. that. And mm-hmm. it's called betaine hydrochloric. But that should be done, you know, with advice.
Advice, right. And given these other things, I'm hearing they are wonderful, but these things would be done after you've taken a wonderful health history and all of that, because I couldn't help but think of with making sure that you're not throwing the metabolic system off and the patient doesn't have some issues in other areas. So
exactly.
This is done under supervision. But when we are talking about flushing, and my last guest, when we were talking to our midlife sister, she talked about the importance of water. Now, when we're talking about bacteria and the small bowel, is it equally as important?
Absolutely, absolutely. Water is life.
It's
for
life.
Us, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we can go a long time without eating, but we can't go a very long time without drinking.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, the process of flushing, of cleansing, of saturating our tissues mm-hmm. So that they can cleanse is so important on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm.
Most of us, including myself, don't get enough water because we get busy.
Right.
And so the risk for developing constipation is a lot greater mm-hmm. if you are dehydrated.
Right.
So that's a very, very important part of keeping, preventing SIBO from happening.
Right.
But also from for keeping you healthy.
Right.
Now, we talked about, in terms of the gut health, we talked about the stomach acid.
Yes.
We also have to pay attention to the environment, the composition of bacteria in the gut.
Oh, yeah.
And so you hear a lot now about probiotics.
Yes.
And the importance of we're more bacteria than we are human cells.
Uh-huh.
There's more bacteria in us
uh-huh.
than human cells.
But many of them are healthy bacteria.
Many of them are healthy bacteria.
Until they mutate on us and do something. And do something ugly. So we have to stay on top of them guys, right?
We have to stay on top of those guys. We have to appreciate the good ones.
Yes.
And feed the good ones
uh-huh.
with fiber, with vegetables,
right.
with fruits, with your water, with
right.
making sure that you're staying away from sugar.
Right.
That you're staying away from processed foods.
Yes.
All right. Those are very key.
Right.
And sometimes, you know, getting a little extra help with taking a good probiotic.
Mm-hmm.
But that should be the recommendation, too, of your doctor.
Well, I know that this irritable bowel syndrome, as well as the overgrowth, could really mess with one's quality of life, the ability to work and everything.
Thank you.
So
yeah.
I want you to do two things for us. I want you to talk a little bit about your practice and let us know who's there and what you do, and just exactly how this can be, how they can be helped if they were to come in for service at your clinic.
Oh, okay, mm-hmm. thank you. Well, as I said, we spend a lot of time with getting a detailed history.
Mm-hmm.
A patient can call, make an appointment. The initial visit is an hour and a half to 2 hours, and they, prior to coming, have filled out a very detailed history form,
mm-hmm.
a health history, bring in old labs so that we can see, you know, what's already been done. Mm-hmm. And then based on that, I'll do a physical exam mm-hmm. and make recommendations for gathering more detailed information. Mm-hmm. We use multiple laboratories that do specific nutrition and very detailed nutritional testing.
So we can look at
the micronutrients. We can look at all of your vitamins, your minerals, your antioxidants. We want to see, is there something that your body is not getting mm-hmm. that it needs to function optimally? And is there something there in the body or in your environment that needs to be taken away
okay.
so that it can function optimally?
Okay. Would they need a referral from someone else?
They don't need a referral. You can refer yourself. As you mentioned, I'm a family practitioner. I'm also in practice okay. with my partner, Dr. Elaine Trogdon, okay. who's a pediatrician.
Women in medicine,
yes,
love it.
That's us. Okay. Mm-hmm. And she does a lot with not just general pediatrics, but with ADD, ADHD,
okay.
natural approaches
attention
to that.
Deficit, yes.
Attention deficit disorder.
Disorders, yes.
Anxiety.
Yeah.
And so even young people are suffering from the same things that adults are because our diets are so horrific.
Yes.
Okay. We do not take insurance.
Okay.
Unfortunately, but we give a fee ticket at the end of the visit that the patient can submit to their insurance company mm-hmm. and generally get paid at out-of-network
okay.
Rates.
Okay.
The reason we don't is because we do spend so much time.
Right.
And insurance companies don't
like that.
Don't like that.
Too much time.
Too much time.
Okay.
Too much
okay. time. So, closing word to them, give them one charge from you today for a healthy gut.
Ooh, that's a challenge. One charge. I would say, you know, really pay attention to what you eat.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody that leaves my office is put on, we call it either an elimination diet.
Okay.
And if you go to website www.whole30, the number 30,
okay.
.com, I encourage people to try that. What you put into your body mm-hmm. makes a difference.
Okay.
Okay, in your energy, in your gut health, and just in how you feel.
Okay. You got it, ladies and gentlemen, and little people too.
Yes.
If you want a healthy gut, gotta be careful what you put in your mouth and in your stomach. I would like to thank Dr. Maggie Covington for being my guest. If you would like to learn more about Partners in Health, visit their website at www.partnersinhealthmd.com. And if you'd like to have more information about the Department of Nursing and Allied Health at the University of the District of Columbia, please visit our website at www.udc.edu/nursing. I'm Dr. Connie Webster. Thank you for watching. Please join me next time, and remember, your health matters.